It's my pleasure to introduce Daniel N. Posner, who's the James S. Coleman Professor of International Development in the Department of Political Science at UCLA. His research focuses on ethnic politics, research design, distributive politics, and the political economy of development in Africa. And he's really one of the foremost African political scientists studying Africa. So he's the co-author of Co-Ethnicity, Diversity and the Dilemmas of Collective Action, published by Russell Sage in 2009, and author of Ethnic Politics in Africa, published by Cambridge in 2005. And he has published articles in all of the best journals in political science and beyond. He is the co-founder of the Working Group in African Political Economy. He received his bachelor's degree from Dartmouth College and his PhD from Harvard University. Please welcome Dan Posner.
Well, thank you, Dan, for that introduction, and all of you for coming. It's really a pleasure to be here. So the motivation for this talk is that every year, development agencies and donors and others spend billions of dollars trying to improve the quality of life for poor people in poor countries. But, you know, not all that money is well spent. And so a big question is, what works? Which of these many interventions actually deliver benefits and which ones don't? It's a question we want an answer to so we can figure out how best to target our donor money. There are a couple different ways in which we might try to answer that question. One way is case studies, right? So there's a group out of Princeton called Innovations for Successful Societies, which collects really extraordinary case studies of successful development programs. The problem with that kind of approach is that they're only focusing on the successful programs. They're not focusing on the ones that are unsuccessful. And of course, we can't learn about what works if we only focus on success. The other problem, of course, is generalizability. I mean, if we have some fantastic case study of some highly successful program, I don't know, to provide fertilizer for farmers in Mongolia, we want to know whether that same program will work in Mali or Bangladesh. And we can't tell just from studying that one very well done, even successful case study in that one place. So case studies are valuable, but they're limited. Another approach is to do very large N controlled comparisons, where you collect data on outcomes of interest, like governance or the success of development programming, and then other variables of interest at the country level to try to figure out what associations there may be in the world between regime type or institutions and successful development outcomes. So the World Bank collects its worldwide governance indicators, which are motivated by exactly this function. The VDEM Institute in Gothenburg in Sweden does something similar. So this is a different approach. It has a different set of drawbacks. One is endogeneity. I mean, supposing we find an association between, say, democracy and successful development programming. Is that because democracy causes programming to be successful? Or is it because the accumulation of successful development programming makes democracy more likely to emerge or to endure? There's a chicken-egg problem there. We don't know which is which. Furthermore, there's the problem of confoundingness. It could be that there's some third factor, geography, level of wealth, culture, something else that explains both a country's success in development programming and its institutions, right? And so both of these problems, endogeneity and confoundingness, mean that there's a limit to what we can learn from these kinds of large-N cross-national studies. So there's a third approach, which I'm going to talk about today, which is experiments. So the Poverty Action Lab out of MIT and the Evidence and Governance and Politics Network, which Dan and I are both part of, are at the forefront of trying to do very careful, randomized experiments in developing countries to try to figure out which kinds of development programs work and which don't. The strength of the experimental approach is that if you randomize units, villages, towns, policymakers, what have you, where some of them get some treatment and some of them don't, that permits you to make causal inferences by comparing the average outcomes you get in the units that got the treatment and the units that didn't. And the reason that it allows you to do that is because if you're randomizing, in expectation, you're going to see the same thing in the treated and controlled units absent treatment. And so if you see a difference in the treated than the control units, then the power of randomization is that you can make a causal inference about the treatment having been responsible for that difference that you observe in average outcomes, right? And then the other attractive thing, which is particularly appealing for me, is the math is really simple. You don't need fancy regressions. You don't need fancy statistical models. A properly designed, randomized, controlled trial only requires a very simple difference of means test. If on average the outcomes are statistically significantly different in the treated and control units, you can conclude that the treatment had some effect, okay? There are, however, some real weaknesses to that approach. First and foremost, it's a powerful method, but it can't be used for a whole host of causal variables, to test the impact of a whole host of causal variables that we have reason to think really matter, but that we can't randomize. So, for example, a major question in political economy is whether regime type or political institutions matter for development outcomes, right? But you can't randomize whether one country is a democracy or not, right? You can't go to Swaziland and change their institutions, right? The IRB is not going to let you do that, and it's immoral. You can't. Or the characteristic of leaders, right? We know in our gut that the fact that Singapore had Lee Kuan Yew as its leader mattered for Singapore's development. And we know in our gut that the fact that Zaire had Mobutu as its leader probably affected its development. But we can't switch Mobutu and Lee Kuan Yew and put Lee Kuan Yew in charge of Zaire and Mobutu in charge of Singapore to see what'll happen. So that's a question that we just can't answer, right? Or levels of social diversity. There's a huge literature suggesting that societies that are ethnically diverse or culturally diverse or religiously diverse have different outcomes than societies that are more homogeneous. But you can't change a society's level of diversity, short of genocide and ethnic cleansing, which of course we can't do. There's this whole other literature suggesting that exposure to war or violence has a profound effect on development outcomes. And in our guts, we know that it probably does, but we can't start a war or, unfortunately, end a war in order to, and do that in a lot of places at random. So the point is there's an awful lot of things, questions we would love to be able to answer that experiments don't seem to provide a lot of leverage for as powerful instruments as they might otherwise be. Now, there is a class of experiments that provide something of a workaround, and these are what are called natural experiments. So for example, there are a lot of country borders in the world that are drawn arbitrarily by Europeans who were colonizing, who drew borders in areas where they had no idea what kinds of peoples and communities they were bisecting. And so there's a whole literature where researchers leverage those arbitrary boundaries to be able to compare outcomes on either side of that border with the claim that the fact that some people are on the west side of the border and some are on the east is as if they had randomly been assigned because the border was arbitrarily drawn, and then they can make the case that the differences that they see on either side of the border are due to things like the different institutions that were put in place in the countries that the border divides. Or, for example, there have been researchers who have leveraged moments when leaders in office die of natural causes, which you can think of as an exogenous change in leadership, and they leverage that to see what the effect of leadership might be. Or other studies that leverage the fact that in some countries, there are rules that reserve seats for members of minority groups or for women, and they do this at random, and so you can compare outcomes in places where you have, through this process, a woman or a minority group member leading, say, a village council versus not. Or to get at diversity, which you can't change, you might nonetheless leverage the fact that at universities, roommates are often assigned at random. And so roommates are sometimes of the same group, sometimes of different groups. Or as David Layton and some of his colleagues recently did in France, they took advantage of the fact that assignment to public housing in France is done randomly. And so some housing, public housing buildings are diverse and some not. And so you can compare outcomes across them. Chris Blattman has this very nice study where he looks at people who were abducted by the Lord's Resistance Army in Uganda, which he claims was basically random. If you were a young man, chances were pretty good you'd be abducted, and whether or not you were was just like random chance. And so he could compare labor market outcomes of people who were subjected to violence by having been abducted to labor market outcomes among people who were lucky enough not to have been, right? So natural experiments provide a potential workaround to study some of these really important but hard to study outcomes or causal factors, at least hard to study experimentally, but you can't always count on finding a natural experiment. And they also rely on an assumption that the assignment to these different treatments are as if random. And usually there's an argument for why that's plausible, but at least purists will often dispute that. And purists will say, no, unless you, the researcher, are randomly assigning people to treatment and control, it's just not an experiment. You're kidding yourself if you think it is, right? Okay, so there are problems, but that said, there are lots of things you can randomize, even in the area of governance. And there's been a whole bunch of really clever, innovative experimental work that's been done to address, for example, how citizens respond to information about the corruption of elected officials, or about whether vote buying is effective, and if it is, how to reduce it, or about how to boost electoral turnout, especially among women or members of underrepresented groups, or whether politicians are more responsive to members of their own ethnic group versus members of other groups, or how exposure to violence affects political attitudes, or how to promote reconciliation in post-conflict settings. There are really nice studies attached to each of these bullet points. But the point of this slide is just to demonstrate that in the area of governance, it is possible to use experimental techniques to get the beginnings of answers to some pretty important and fundamental questions. So my point is that, sort of the glass is half full, is that we learn a tremendous amount from these studies. And we learn a tremendous amount from them because randomization, which is at the core of these experimental studies, gives us confidence in the causal claims that the authors of these studies make. But this whole experimental turn raises some real questions, and so I want to talk about some of those. The first question is, do these studies replicate? Are they just one-off experiments that tell us something about something that happened at a particular time, in a particular place, when the data collection efforts were undertaken by a particular set of researchers, or do they tell us something general, right? And the dirty secret is that most experimental studies don't replicate. Now, this is not something that's unique to experimental studies of governance. There was a recent issue of Nature that published this table this year. So they surveyed hard scientists in chemistry, biology, physics, and so forth, and asked them, have you ever failed to reproduce an experiment that you've undertaken, or have you ever failed to reproduce an experiment that somebody else had undertaken? Look at these extraordinary numbers. In chemistry, the people surveyed, close to 90% said that they had the experience, I guess at least once, of failing to replicate somebody else's experimental study. And remarkably, about 65% of them reported having failed to replicate even their own study, right? And so you see these very, very high rates of failure. Now, this doesn't mean that 80% of studies in chemistry aren't replicable. It means that 80% of researchers reported having failed to replicate at least one study. But it suggests that replicability is a big problem across the sciences in experimental work. Okay, so replication is challenging, and the challenge is compounded by the fact that there are very low incentives for replication. If you are the first person to have thought up some intervention and rolled it out and reported the results, you may get your paper published in a really good journal, and you may get a lot of attention. It might even get you a promotion in your profession. But if you replicate somebody else's study, that is, from a scientific standpoint, an extraordinarily important thing to do. But the professional rewards for replicating somebody else's study, even your own study, are much, much less than doing the first. And as a consequence, you've got all these people doing one-off studies in virgin territory, and far fewer people replicating studies that inform our sense of what works and what doesn't. Right, and that's because you just don't have the same incentives for replication. There are moves underway to try to change that, but it's really, really hard, okay? Okay, there has been some recent progress on this score. So EGAP, this group that I mentioned, has this extraordinary initiative called metiqueta. So metiqueta is the Basque word for replication. And what EGAP has done is gotten a whole bunch of money to put out requests for proposals to researchers who would all do different projects in different places, but they would agree to have a common treatment arm across all of their projects. And so there's this nice balance between the researchers' independence to study their own thing and the researchers' commitment to study at least one thing in the same way as these other researchers. And so what EGAP does is it coordinates all of these research projects. It funds them and coordinates them so that at the end of the project, you will have 6 or 7 common treatment arms across bunches of projects in different settings undertaken by different researchers that can allow us to see in a general sense whether the same treatment has different effects in different settings. They've done one of these, the first round, which is concluding, was on issues of information and accountability, very close to the study I'm going to talk about in a minute. They now have one in natural resources, one in taxation, and one, I think, in community policing. So it's an extraordinary initiative. I think it's exactly what we need to be doing to take the next step in the experimental revolution. And so it's really noteworthy, and it's a big deal. 3IE is a, I don't know what 3IE is. It's an NGO that is research promoting. They have an initiative where they will pay people to replicate, to undertake replications of a dozen or so very famous studies that they've identified as being influential, where we can learn to see whether those results replicate. So that's another noteworthy thing. And more broadly, apart from these initiatives, there's a welcome and much greater emphasis in experimental work on heterogeneous treatment effects. That is, not just estimating whether on average some treatment has an effect when you compare the treated units to the control units, but unpacking the kinds of treated units so that you can say something about the conditions under which the treatment is stronger or weaker, right? And strictly speaking, that's not experimental, because you're not randomizing the characteristics that vary across the treated units, right? But it's at least a step in the direction of addressing the question of whether the findings from the main study can be generalized, or at least the conditions under which we would expect them to generalize more or less strongly, okay? Okay. The other big question that I think the work to date has not been very good at addressing is the question of what's the mechanism that underlies the finding, right? So there's a lot of pressure, I think, now to move from posing the question, does it work, to the question of why does it work? What's the mechanism? What are the channels through which this treatment is having its effect? And so you can think of this as moving from where randomized controlled trials started, which is looking at program evaluation, I think the mic just went out, to thinking about how the world works in general, okay? And my sense is that that's the real research frontier. And although by and large studies haven't really done this to date, I think that well-designed, and we're back. I think well-designed experiments can achieve that goal of moving us from does it work to why does it work by really looking at mechanisms. Okay, so that was all sort of preamble. Although preamble doesn't mean that was the first tenth of the talk and now 90% is coming. So what I want to do in the rest of the talk is, having laid out that general background, I want to walk through a study I've been involved with in the last couple of years that tries to tackle, in its design, some of these issues. This is a project called Accountability Can Transform Health, or ACT Health. So this is a large-scale study that I've been working on with Doug Parkerson, who works at Innovations for Poverty Action, and Pia Raffler, who's a graduate student at Yale University, although she's about to take a tenure-track position someplace. So the project, or our project, is designed as a follow-up to a very famous study undertaken or published in 2009 by Martina Bjorkman and Jakob Svensson called Power to the People, or P2P. So where we are in our studies, we've finished collecting our endline data and are poised to start looking at it. So I'm unfortunately not going to be presenting any results of our study, but I'm going to instead be focusing on the ways in which we designed it so as to be able to, as sort of a model for how we can move our experimental work more in the direction of addressing these questions of under what conditions does something work and why, okay? So, okay, that's what I just said. So let me tell you about this, the P2P study. So the objective of the study, or of the intervention that the study was measuring the effects of, was to try to improve service delivery and health outcomes in rural Uganda. It was an extremely intensive intervention. So it involved first measuring the quality of healthcare provision that was being provided at rural clinics in Uganda and the health status of community members. It then summarized the information that was collected in report cards that were tailor-made for each health center and each catchment area, which is the people who get their health services from that health center. It then disseminated those report cards both to members of the community and to the health center staff, so they had a real concrete sense of how they were doing. They then worked with members of the community and with the clinic staff independently to develop action plans, laying out what they might do independently of one another to improve healthcare provision and health outcomes in light of the information provided in the report cards. They then held what they called interface meetings between members of the community and the health center staff so that they could collaboratively work together. They could bring their action plans that they had independently put together and work together to put together what they called a social contract that laid out specifically what community members and what health center staff could do together and independently in order to improve health outcomes. The team of researchers spent 5 days working with the community, doing all of these things in each community, and then they followed up with a booster visit 6 months later where they came back, held some more meetings, and made sure that people were still going with the program, okay? It's an incredibly intense, multifaceted intervention, and the way they estimated the treatment effects was by comparing baseline data, this was the data they collected that informed the report cards, with end-line data that they collected a year later, both in the clinics that did and didn't receive this multifaceted treatment, okay? It was a relatively small sample, just 25 health centers and associated catchment areas that got the treatment and 25 that were randomly assigned not to, to be in the control. It was spread over 9 districts in Uganda. But notwithstanding the small sample size, Bjorkman and Svensson report these huge, almost unbelievably large effects. So infant weights were significantly higher in the units that got this treatment. Under 5 mortality was 33% lower in 1 year if you compared baseline and endline in the 25 units on average that got the treatment versus those that didn't. Immunization rates were higher in the treated units. Staff absenteeism and waiting times at clinics were lower in the treated units, right? Enormous results. Very, very exciting to the policy community for, I think, 2 reasons. One, first of all, it's rare that health interventions of any kind have these kinds of effects. But the reason why these findings were so important and so celebrated was, first, the intervention wasn't about spending more money. It wasn't about buying new ambulances or building clinics or training doctors and nurses or buying equipment. It was about wringing more efficiency out of the existing physical and human infrastructure. And from the standpoint of donors who want to affect big change without spending huge amounts of money, and of course, developing country governments, that was an incredibly exciting thing to be able to show, right? The second reason it was very exciting was because this whole approach, which was premised on the idea that you could mobilize people from the bottom up to exert pressure on healthcare providers to affect change, was very much in keeping with a move in development circles away from top-down interventions toward bottom-up interventions. For a long time, the way it was thought that we do development is you have these very well-trained experts from outside who know what to do, and they come in and do it for, or sometimes to, local poor populations, and then that's the secret. And there's been just abundant research, most famously articulated by Bill Easterly, suggesting that that kind of a top-down approach just doesn't work. And so there was a hunger for an alternative, and the big alternative that's been celebrated in a whole bunch of literature, and these 2 books, Localizing Development, Does Participation Work? Making Politics Work for Development, Harnessing Transparency and Citizen Engagement. These are two very recent World Bank studies. They both articulate this new zeitgeist that the way to do development is to take advantage of the fact that people actually in developing countries now have the freedom to speak out, to apply pressure, and use those freedoms for them to apply pressure on service providers and elected officials to improve the quality of what they're doing, right? So this was the idea that everybody was excited about, and along comes a study that suggests that, yeah, there's merit to this. It can deliver big effects, right? So there was very strong interest in seeing whether the results replicate, and that's where we come in to try to provide an answer. So ACT Health was rolled out on a much larger scale than the P2P study that we were following up on. So they worked in 9 districts, we're working in 16. They worked in 50 health centers, we're working in 379. We collected baseline data in 15,500 households, because we collected data in 40-odd households in the catchment area of each of the 379 clinics. And it was a panel, which means that we collected the data at baseline, and then we went back to the same households a year later, and then a year after that. So it's a 3-wave panel with 15,000 households, and thanks to the skill of our research team, our attrition rate was an almost unbelievable less than 5%, in part because we took the geolocations of households, we spent a lot of time in the communities, so we're very proud of those figures. IPA, which was our team that was actually doing the data collection, reports that this is the largest panel survey they've ever done. It's pretty huge. The other noteworthy thing about this, and this is in keeping with a broader move in this kind of work, is before we even started the work, or at any rate, before we looked at any of the data, we pre-specified all of our hypotheses that we were testing and all of the operationalizations of all of our variables, how we were going to use the data we collected and put it in a form so we could statistically test for effects, and all of the specifications of the statistical analysis we were going to run, we wrote it all down and said, this is what we're going to do. And we filed that publicly in something called a pre-analysis plan, so that now that we have the data, we just are going to run all those analyses in the pre-analysis plan. The purpose of pre-analysis plans is to tie your hands. When you're doing a big project like this, there's a temptation to run tons of analyses, and if some of them show that there's some significant effect and some don't, you highlight the ones that show the effect that you're rooting for and bury the others. Or if you get an effect that's not quite statistically significant, maybe you say, gosh, well, maybe we were wrong to include all the villages. Maybe we should only include villages of this type, and you tweak the specification or the way you define variables until it generates results. Now, of course, the results that then get published look to the consumer of those results like there's some important effect, but really the effect was just a function of your cherry picking and your fishing in your data for something to report, right? There still is a bias against null findings in research journals. And knowing that, there's an incentive to fish. And so pre-analysis plans are a way of tying your hands to prevent that, because we are publicly on record with exactly what analyses we're going to run. And now that we have the data, we just plug it in, and we run it, and then we've got what we've got. And that kind of a move really increases the credibility of the scientific enterprise. So that's another thing we did. We're not alone in that. Lots and lots of that's now de rigueur in this kind of work. Okay, so let me tell you about the strategies that we built into the project to try to do two things. One, to answer the question, where does it work, or for what kinds of people or what kinds of communities is this most likely to work? And then I'm going to talk about mechanisms in a minute. So to get at these questions, we look at what are called heterogeneous treatment effects. And so in addition to just rolling this out, we collected a whole lot of information about the characteristics of the different health facilities so we could answer the question, in what kinds of health facilities do we see bigger or smaller effects of the intervention? So first of all, the healthcare system in Uganda is tiered. It's hierarchically set up. So the lowest level of healthcare delivery is the HC2, the Health Center 2. These are like rural posts. where maybe there's a nurse or a midwife and that's it. Then the next level up is the HC3. There you have a doctor or two, a nursing staff, a midwife, some cleaners, and more of a staff. And so one thing we wanted to know is, does this kind of treatment have a different impact at when it's done in an HC2 versus an HC3? And there are lots of reasons we could talk about later why that might be. But we collected information, obviously, on whether it was an HC2 or HC3, so we could test for differential effects across those two types. We also sliced the data based on the level of performance of the health center at baseline, right? So we collected at baseline information on the quality of treatment being provided at the health centers, and we can compare health centers that are above and below the median treatment level in their district. And the purpose of this is to test the hypothesis, which is quite plausible, that health centers that are already performing well, there's a ceiling effect. They're not going to have as big an effect as health centers that are really poorly performing. And so this heterogeneous treatment effect, which would get masked in a normal study where you're just looking at average outcomes across treated and control units, is something that we also are going to look at. We also collected information about the availability of other healthcare options in the area. So think about what this intervention does. It's appealing to people to expend time and energy to monitor their healthcare providers and then expend more time and energy to sanction them if they're not performing well. Well, that's all about exercising voice, and it's costly. And so one way you might respond to a report card suggesting your health clinic isn't doing very well is to mobilize exactly as this intervention intends, to exercise voice and apply pressure. Another thing you might do is just say, forget it. I'm going to go to the NGO clinic. I'm going to go to the church clinic that's a little bit further walk, but now that I know that my government clinic isn't performing, I'm just going to go elsewhere. And so we might think that you'd have very different treatment effects in places where there are and are not alternative outcomes for healthcare. So we collected information on that. We also collected a bunch of information about the characteristics of the community in the catchment area that's served by the clinic. So as I said, the way that the program is supposed to work is it's supposed to cause community members to mobilize to collectively apply pressure on healthcare providers. But some communities are going to be better able to do that than others. And so we asked a question at baseline, if you wanted to take action to improve the quality of healthcare provided at your health center, do you think other community members would join you in that effort, right? We consider this a measure of perceived collective action potential. If you think nobody else is going to join, you're not going to be the sucker and do it yourself. It's only if you think others will join in this collective effort to apply pressure that you're going to do it. And so it's plausible to think that communities where lots of people answer yes to that question are going to be ones where we should see a stronger effect. And communities where they answer no, we'll see a weaker effect. There's also been literature suggesting that a community's ethnic heterogeneity might affect the ability of people to mobilize and work together collectively. And so we also look at the ethnic heterogeneity of the community because we think that's another proxy for the community's collective action potential. We also look at the level of ongoing community monitoring that's happening at baseline. The rationale here is that if people are already monitoring the heck out of the healthcare providers, then they're not going to be able to do more. But if they're not, then the intervention might cause them to change and to start monitoring at a higher level, which might lead to a change in outcomes, right? So to get at that, we looked at whether people in the community regularly attend LC1 meetings. These are local community meetings. Whether the health center and the quality of service provision being provided at the health center is ever discussed at LC1 meetings, and whether the health unit monitoring committee, which is a usually moribund but nonetheless formally on the books citizen health unit monitoring committee, as the title suggests, whether it's active or whether it's not. Okay. We also looked at the sense of efficacy community members have. The reason why we think this is important is because there's been a huge literature looking at providing people with information, trying to get them to mobilize to affect change. And most of the results are very weak. The P2P study is one of the few exceptions. And part of the reason I think most of the results are weak is because many community members in settings like this just think that they don't have power to affect change. either because the system is going to push back and prevent change from happening, or because they just personally are powerless. How can I change what this high-status health provider is doing, whether he's taking long breaks and so forth? And so we think that there might be variation in the impact of this treatment based on how much efficacy people in the community have, right? And so to get at that, we ask questions about whether you think you have the ability to influence outcomes in a way so that you can make your village a better place to live, or whether people like you have a say about how the government or the health center provides health care, or whether people like you have the power to improve the quality of health care in your community. The idea is that if people are answering no to, for example, those last two questions, then telling people, hey, you should try to affect change probably isn't going to do anything, because people are convinced at baseline, before you even arrive, that they can't. Okay? Okay. So those are a bunch of characteristics of the community or of the health center that we think vary plausibly across the units that we're treating, and whose variation we think is plausibly going to be associated with the impact of the intervention. And so, unlike many studies which ignore this, we deliberately collected a lot of information so as to be able to test for these heterogeneous treatment effects on these dimensions. There's one other heterogeneous treatment effect of interest that I want to mention. So the way the project was set up is, let's say in a village you collect the baseline data in January of 2012, then you want to collect the endline data in January of 2013. You want to have the dates of the data collection effort be as close as possible to exactly 1 year apart to control for all sorts of cyclical things that affect health outcomes. So for example, if you collected the data in the rainy season, malaria is going to be higher. And then if you collected the endline data in the dry season, malaria is going to be lower. Health outcomes are going to be better, not because they improved, but just because the disease burden was different. So we want to be very careful about baseline and endline being exactly a year apart. Ideally, we would have then a common interval between when we rolled out the treatment and when we measured the endline, the effects through the endline data collection. But we're working at 379 units. It's really hard to make sure that it's a common interval. And so here's a histogram. We did the best we could, but it wasn't perfect. So here's a histogram showing the interval between the time we showed up in the village to do our intervention and the time we collected endline data on the effects. So on average, it was 8.5 months. But the minimum was 6 months, and the maximum was 11 months. And we can't rule out the possibility that in the ones where there was an 11-month interval, maybe the effect of the intervention had already dissipated by the time we showed up to measure outcomes. And we can't rule out that in the 6 month, the ones with the 6 month interval, or at any rate, the shorter end, that maybe there wasn't enough time that had elapsed for the intervention to have had an effect. We don't know which of those might be true, but we know that it could be a problem. And so we collect information on that, the size of that interval in every unit, and we can then control for that and see whether it matters. Okay? Okay. These are, again, all different ways we're trying to think about variation across the units to try to understand the conditions under which the effect is going to be stronger or weaker. Let me quickly say something about mechanisms. This is moving from the question of does it work to the question of why does it work. So we employ two different strategies to try to understand, to the extent that we find an effect, why we're finding it. What's the mechanism? So the first thing we do is we investigate intermediate outcomes. So the logic here is that if we want to know whether X is causing Y through some mechanism Q, we can estimate the impact of X on Q. Now, to really do this formally requires very complicated mediation analysis, which we don't do. It's a very controversial thing, and we don't do it. But it's at least plausible. If X is affecting Y through Q, we should see an effect of X on Q. If we don't, then it's totally implausible that X is affecting Y through Q, right? So we identify a whole bunch of Qs, that is, factors that we think are capturing what that channel might be, and then estimate whether we see a relationship between X and these intermediate outcomes as a way of getting a handle on the mechanism. The other thing we do is we employ what's called a factorial design, where we break up the very complicated P2P intervention into its most important parts, and then compare the separate and combined effect of each of these different parts of the intervention. And I'll tell you about that in a minute. So intermediate outcomes. I'll go through this quickly. It's possible that the reason why P2P worked is because it changed the knowledge that community members had about what health outcomes they were entitled to, what were their rights and responsibilities, and what kinds of services are supposed to be being provided at their health center, even if they're not being provided. Right? This is this idea that information is what's doing the work. If that's true, then we should see that the treated units, or that community members' knowledge about their rights and responsibilities and about things that should be provided at the health center should be higher in the treated units than the untreated ones. So we test that. You might see something similar going on at the level of the healthcare providers, who before treatment didn't know what the rights and responsibilities of community members are. This is kind of implausible. They're supposed to have a poster in the clinic that lays out the rights and responsibilities. It wasn't always there, but they're supposed to. But anyway, we test this. Earlier, we talked about efficacy as a source of heterogeneous treatment effects. It could be that it's actually part of the mechanism, that what these mobilization meetings do when you have this trained outsider come in and supervise a meeting where you're talking about what we can learn from the report card and how we can apply pressure to affect change, that increases people's efficacy, that they actually can affect change. And so maybe we're going to see some effect of treatment on efficacy. So we look at that. It could be that community members pre-treatment thought that it was the responsibility of district officials to make sure that the healthcare providers were doing their job, and that's not for us. That's for somebody else. And so it could be that what the treatment did was it changed people's perceptions of what they were responsible for doing themselves. And so we look at that. We also looked at whether whether community members are in fact monitoring the health center staff and outcomes there. If they're not, that raises questions about what the mechanism is supposed to be, which is that you're increasing monitoring, right? And it's also possible that pre-treatment, the relationship between health center staff and community members was terrible. That's what a lot of people told us in the focus groups that we did beforehand. There's a big status differential between members of the community and health center staff who are doctors and nurses, and they're just from a different socioeconomic status. They're better educated, they have skills. And so it's sometimes hard for poor villagers to show up and go toe-to-toe with an underperforming doctor or nurse and to tell them that they're not doing their job. And so maybe the key is the interface meeting that brings them together as equals where they can talk about how to work together to improve outcomes. So maybe that's it. So we look at whether that relationship changed in the treated units as well, okay? So that's one strategy, is looking at intermediate outcomes. The other involves breaking apart the incredibly complicated P2P intervention into a couple of pieces. It's really hard to know, if you read the initial Bjorkman-Svensson paper, which piece of the intervention is doing the work. Is it the collection and dissemination of the report card information? Is it the collection and dissemination of the report card information not to the community, but to the clinic staff? Is it the development of the action plan within the community? What is it, right? So to try to figure out which of those things is doing the work, we break the P2P intervention into two parts and employ a factorial design so different subsets of our sample get different parts of the broader intervention. So there's lots of ways you could have divided these different components. We had to divide them and group them into two. So treatment one involved what we call information and mobilization. So it involved collecting and disseminating the report card information to the clinic staff and to members of the community and mobilizing each independently in light of that information. And then treatment two was the interface meeting, bringing members of the community and members of the clinic staff together to try to talk about how they could improve healthcare outcomes in the catchment area, okay? So the design formally looks like this. The rows are whether or not the report card information was disseminated and whether mobilization was happening independently in the community and among the clinic staff, and the columns are whether or not the interface meetings are held. So the upper left cell is our pure control where none of this is happening. The bottom right cell is the combined effect of these pieces, which is the P2P replication. But we can then unpack this by comparing the columns and the rows. And by doing that, draw power from the whole sample in answering this question, Is it mobilization and information, or is it the interface meeting? And we can talk later about why we divided things as we did, but that was the choice. This is what the sample looks like in each cell. Got a lot more power, even just in this comparison, than Bjorkman and Svensson, which had 25 in each. okay, so summary. So experimental methods are really powerful, and they're promising, even for topics that are hard to study, like governance. But we need to do a better job, I think, and my colleagues think, of designing them to specify first the conditions under which the findings that the study generates are more or less likely to hold, and second, the mechanisms that underpin the effects that we're identifying. And the ACT Health project that I told you a little bit about is, I think, an example of a study that tries to build into its design the ability to try to answer these questions, and we'll keep you posted on what we find. Thank you.
Of minutes for questions, but we want to hear from you. And so just to expedite that, please come on up to the wired microphone, tell us your name and what you're studying. We'll try to get through a few questions before everyone has to run out to their next class. Time's short.
In the action potential and the sense of efficacy variables that you're looking at, mm-hmm. and your hypothesis that if those were low at baseline, that might then affect a lower treatment outcome. And I know this is pre-analysis, but if that does turn out to be the case, can you tell us like a little bit more about what your next steps might be as researchers and what changes you might make to address those?
Yeah, so I've done some other work in Kenya looking at the impact of an education program that involved giving parents information about the quality of schooling their kids were getting based on, or the quality of learning based on giving them tests of English and Swahili and math. And we found that had no effect on kids' outcomes and had no effect on parents' mobilization to try to affect change. And my co-authors and I, a different set on that project, scratched our heads and tried to figure out what was going on. And two of the main things that we think were doing the work was the fact that parents would get this information, and first of all, often they knew that their kids weren't doing very well, so the treatment wasn't giving them anything new. But even if they knew, if it was news to them, they often felt like, I just don't have the power to change things. So if we do find that there isn't a treatment effect in our replication, my suspicion is that a big part of it is going to be that efficacy mechanism. I think that in developing country settings, people just don't feel like they have the power to change things. One of the dangers of a study like this is in the mobilization component, we have our partners who are going to communities and telling people you can affect change. And so if they learn that they can't, then the worry is that that's going to be deeply discouraging and might undermine the ability of people to mobilize in the future. And there have been some studies that look at this. There was a study in Mexico where people were given information about the level of corruption of their mayor who was about to run for re-election. And the hope was that by exposing corrupt mayors with real concrete information about diverting funds, you were going to get people to turn out in droves to vote them out. And in turn, it wound up depressing turnout. People basically just said, you know, I thought corruption was a problem. Now I know it's a problem, and I'm just washing my hands of this whole politics thing. So my hunch is if we find a weak effect, that's going to be part of it.
Right.
I'm heartened that we're in a position to be able to put our finger on that by dint of our design. As for what we do, I don't know. The danger is anything you try to do to boost people's sense of efficacy can backfire unless you can show that mobilization actually can change things. And so maybe what we need for that is just more democracy, which is weak in Uganda. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Sierra Davis. I'm studying political science. Danielson has us read a lot of your work, and it's been really good. What areas in the development literature are most, I guess you could say, deficient in terms of having randomized control trials? Where is work needing to be done?
Well, that's a tough question. I mean, I think part a lot of it is on these big questions, where we intuitively think these factors must matter, like institutions, but where we can't randomize them. So I would say one of the big questions, and you know, Acemoglu and Robinson and all these folks talk about it, is democracy, autocracy, and its effect on development. That's just a very hard thing to study using randomized techniques, because you can't randomize, at least at the country level, any of these factors. You can come close to doing it, maybe at a local level, if you have, for example, a decentralization program that's being rolled out over time that provides more democratic input for people, or, for example, in Afghanistan, there was a program that gave community members a vote in how development spending was going to be allocated. So that's kind of like a mini interjection of democracy, which you can randomize because you're doing this in these village councils. But that's very removed from changing a whole national political regime. And so I think the things that are most important from a theoretical standpoint, but least amenable to this kind of work, is causal variables that vary at the level of the country as a whole. We just can't change those things, unfortunately. Well, we can't change those things. Whether it's fortunate or not, we can't change them.
Thanks.
Thanks.
All right. Thanks for your questions, and please join me in thanking Dan Posner.
Thank you.